and frames. So it is a fairly comprehensive youth accessory fashion brand, and it has been around now for about 20 years. And the journey of Fast Track is interesting because it has always been squarely focused on young people. This brand, when it used to be a sub-brand of the main brand Titan, and it became a separate sub-brand around 2003-04. And so it's been so many years in which generations of people have come into Fast Track and moved out of Fast Track. You know, we think that people who are around 20 to 22 are the ideal consumers of Fast Track. There are a lot of 13 and 14 year olds who aspire, and there are a lot of 30 year olds who continue to use, but really we are razor sharp focused on the 20 year old. And today's topic, which is about millennials, is actually on that 20 year old. So when this brand was launched in 2003-04, the 20 year old then is actually much older now. You can imagine it has been almost more than two decades. So it's moved on. But the point is, that generation had a certain attitude towards life, towards themselves, towards the opposite sex, towards ambition. And that has actually shifted. And I'll quickly take you through how that shift has happened over the years. So if you can play the video one. This was actually, in a way, the video that the ad that launched Fast Track.
Simi.
Yes, sir.
Raj.
Yes, sir.
Raj.
Oh, yes, sir. Yes.
So this is the generation then. As you can see, it's quite risque, it's cheeky, it's fun, it's humorous. There's a play of on attraction towards the opposite sex. And yet it is in a larger social context where there are a lot of people and, you know, it's fun. If this really shook up the Indian consumer market at that point, because it directly brought to the forefront the whole subject of sexual attraction among young people, and it was really taboo at that time. And there was a certain element of, I would say, rebelliousness, where all of these young women are actually, you know, playing, quote unquote, with this young man. This point, this was something that really worked for this brand, and of course it brought in an angle of being very edgy and very cool at that point. Cut to about 2008, 9, 10. By now, we realize that this generation was so, you know, they were so influenced by the parental generation, and therefore there was an element of rebellion. By 2008, 9, 10, we realized that young people were absolutely comfortable with having relationships, and it was no longer a taboo subject. It was something that they were experimenting in a lot more. And this brand, while the core of it remained in fashion and affordable fashion, the brand attitude changed, and the tagline, "Move On," came here. The point here was that by this time, young people were looking at life with an eye on experimentation. That I must not get fixed. I must try out everything in life. I have to try on various things, and only then I will get the full joy of life. So if we can play the video number two.
Okay.
So as you can see here, by this time, the 20, bullseye 22 year old was now perfectly okay with a lot of experimentation. Now I've moved to, say, 2017-18. Now what has happened is, and a little bit actually Kiran spoke about, is that strangely enough, youth has become more conservative instead of becoming more liberal. And there are a lot of different things that are happening in the world, in India, and the youth are now much more focused, not focused, influenced by social media. So they all have two lives. One is the real life and one is the virtual life. And the real life is desperately trying to move up to the excitement and appeal of the virtual life. And this dichotomy in their heads has put in a spin into the whole relationship equation, which is what Fast Track has always played with. So you will see this in the video number 3. Can you play that, please?
Presenting the story of your life. Swipe right, that's right. Boy meets girl, girl meets boy, first and second. Ever. Let's start over. Presenting the story of your life by Fast Track. Boy meets girl.
Hey.
Girl meets boy.
Nice bag.
Cool shades.
Love the watch.
Wanna see what else I got?
Real happy endings. Shut the fake up. Watches, shades, bags and more. From Fast Track.
So you see now, here the dilemma of the whole generation has shifted to, there's so much fake stuff going on online that in order to have a real relationship, you actually have to give that up and have a real conversation with a real person of the opposite sex. So this has been the journey of Fast Track, and the last one is where the current youth, which is what we are defining as the millennial, is at, where they're rejecting fakeness, they're embracing authenticity. And this is the reality. All around us, we have young people who are seeking authenticity, not just in relationships, but in life, in their purpose of the work that they do, and in the impact that they can have in the world around them. So that's my little take through the story of Fast Track. Kira.
Just to remind you that we have two sessions. So this first session is about brands that are old, which have kept track with the changing consumer. So Suparna talked about how Fast Track has been around for 20 years. Some people stick to it, some people don't. Now I'm going to request Sarvesh to talk about an even older brand called Tata Steel and how they have managed to stay in touch with the changing consumer. Sarvesh?
Good morning. Great to have such a large crowd on a braving the public holiday to be here. As Kiran said, I would talk about how a company which has been there for more than 120 years, so we completed 120 years, how it has not only stayed relevant, but has grown from strength to strength. And my 8-10 minutes of showtime would be to present the journey of the company over the last 120 years. So what I've done is that I've split my presentation into two parts. One is 1980, founding times to 1980. Second is beyond 1980. Now it's important to categorize it in such a simple way is to put it in two eras when the economy was closed and when economy was slightly opened up. To start with, 1907, when the company was set up by a gentleman called Jamsetji Tata, the founding father of the Tata Group. Now, what is interesting to note is that that time, 1907, when the plants started working in 1912, to set up a manufacturing setup in the country against all odds was by itself a huge, huge miracle. So we started then. And that time in 1912, when the plant opened up, we said that we'll have 8 hours work time. We said that we'll have pay, we'll have leave without leave with pay. We said that we'll have provident funds. Now these are completely things which were never thought of at that time. In fact, all these went into the various legislations which came out by Government of India and used subsequently. So the whole motive was that how do we be part of the Build India story? How do we be part of building what the country requires and also working very closely with the community around? So we had some examples of Havra Bridge, 1943. Around 38,000 tons of steel has gone in there. 34,000 tons of steel was made especially for the bridge by Tata Steel, that time, 1943. And I think we're all familiar with the bridge here. Not even one sliver of the steel has been replaced. That was Nidada. Then comes 1963, Bhakra Dangal Dam. Let's do something which builds the nation. We are kind of, you know, all our personal or our profit motives and all are subservient to building the nation. Then we talked about working around the community. We had something called huge involvement in sports. In 1984, we have ISLs in the world right now. We had three of the top clubs of the world, people who have been old-timers in the city, PS Eindhoven, Boca Juniors, Beckham, they all came here. They played with Mohan Bagans of the world, East Bengals of the world. And you know, that was the whole philosophy. We set up the Tata Football Academy. That was all till 1980, when the whole motive philosophy was different. We launched a campaign in 1989. I'm going to show you a clipping of that. One of the campaigns which is still very fondly remembered across the generations, and which actually captured the philosophy of the brand till that time.
आशा की ज्योति जगाते हैं, कंधे से कंधा मिलाते हैं, कामयाबी की दिशा में जाते हैं, सभी धर्मों को साथ लाते हैं, इस बात में गर्व पाते हैं, इस बात में हम बनाते हैं।
We also make steel. That was till 1980. After that, things started to change. Economy started opening up. Tata Steel had took on the onus of making the category more exciting. Now, steel as a category is not exciting as Fast Track, which Suparna talked about, or even Amul. But how do you make the category very exciting? And Tata Steel took upon itself the onus of growing the category, making the category very, very hugely exciting. We started with whole journey, started the journey of the brands, 1980. Journey of the brands, then the various awards, debbings, whatever. We had series awards. Since it's a branding session, I'll spend some more time on the brand journey of Tata Steel. 2002, we started with the brand journey. We had those brands, Tata Agrico, Tata Tiscon, Tata Steelium. Now, I just want to emphasize on one thing, that creating a brand did not mean putting a name on the product. That by itself was a huge, huge task. What it worked around was, how do you create an ecosystem of hugely better infrastructure? The whole purpose of marketing of Tata Tiscon rebars is, how do you create a set of engineers and the mysteries and the ecosystem which would not only build better houses, but which would advise people onto creating better houses. So first phase was brand identity. People who have been remotely connected to the brand or with steel as a category. The biggest problem with the category was steel mein chori, weight ka chori. we said that first thing that we'll do is to ensure that the consumers have trust on the brand. And what do? We started writing the thickness on the sheet. On the Stellium brand that we write, the Stellium, which goes into auto manufacturing and goes into furnitures, we had a methodology of putting name, which is a world patent. So idea was, how do you create trust? Take away the fear which is in the minds of the consumer that this product is not only superior quality, but it emerges from House of Tatas. Second phase. So first phase was setting up the brand. Second phase, how do you enable the to actually develop the capability of the channel? So we actually made huge investments in developing the channel, in making them set up service centers. Some of the service centers which you see, which our distributors are carrying now, is they have invested 500 crores in the service centers. They cut, chop, create, make specialized product for the customer, for the auto customer, for the furniture makers. Third was again a very, very momentous time when we went into products which I never seen of by a steel company, and into solutions. Now, all this change has been driven by the changing requirement of the consumers. First need was source identity, phase one. Second was, how do you build the capability so that the right product is served, second wave. Third wave, how do you make them hassle-free service? How do you give them a service where they actually look for a house, and Tata Steel not only provides the steel, but it also enables them to build the house. So we went from steel coils, DISCON, to service solutions. Then to Ashiana. Now this is something which we started last year. Now everything that I talked about has been first time in the steel industry. First time in the steel in the steel industry. Ashiana is a web portal that I'll talk about later. And then third big move is towards new categories. So what we saw right now is we also make steel. Tata Steel is moving into alternate materials, and I'll talk about that in a few seconds. First example of something which any steel company across the world has never heard about. A steel company getting into doors. First, one example that I'm going to kind of show it for the view. So we felt the need that the quality was inconsistent, the pricing was not transparent, the carpenter was not reliable. How do you give a steel door which has the absolute finish of a wooden door? Absolute finish of a wooden door. We have a guy in our role who will go and fix it up in the house, ensure that all the after-sale services are taken care of. So we are moving from providing a coil, moving from providing a product which a consumer like you and me don't see in a daily life, to a product which you see in a house. I mean, even the rebar that we all use is not seen in our uses. So what we are moving on to is making a product which, like any consumer durable, is seen, touched, and felt by the consumer. Then we went into those offerings we talked about, nestings. Now these are small offerings that Tata Steel is hugely into. We have gone into 55 municipal corporations, 15 railways, smart cities. We are setting up these small, like this one which you see is a aqua nest, ATM, water ATM. What you see on the second left is Easy Desk. Those small houses. Now we are building up all those. So the responsibility is not only of providing the steel. Our guy goes and sets it up. Swachh Bharat Abhiyan. So many municipalities that you talked about here are using these facilities to set up those toilets that the government is driving at. And that's where you see the change a steel company moving from a purely a commodity play to a bland brand play to a play where it becomes a daily usage for a human being, for a consumer. Second big step was Ashiana. So we talked about millennial consumers. Ashiana. So we said that if a steel company can experiment on selling on a platform, why not? Let's try it out. Again, the first company to do it. We launched it last year. This year, and then whole purpose was to create an ecosystem, create a platform where the consumer like you and me would not only buy rebars, but also have experts on the platform whom they can consult. They also would have the advice of people around. They will have the material estimator that if I build 2,000 square feet of house, how many steel rods are required, how much of cement is required, how much would it cost to build a house. This year, last year we did the first year, 8 months, we did 150 crores of business. This year we are closing 400 crores of business. The whole surprising thing is that some of the things, some of the buying which is happening is a guy, a son in studying in US, he wants to buy or build a house for his father in Punjab, Kapurthala. He sits there, buys it, and the uniqueness of the model is that there is no channel conflict. Whatever is delivered by the local closest retailer. So the order comes to us, the order is passed on to the guy who is closest to the place where the consumer is and is served through them. 300, 350 crores is what we are looking at this year, hugely, hugely successful, where we thought that no consumer would get into a web to buy steel. We thought that Tata Steel would be primarily a steel company. But we're increasingly moving into composites. We are actually moving to graphene. Graphene is something which has been Tata Steel's proprietary technology. The whole aspiration is that next 2 years, this year's plan, FY20 plan, is alternate commodity, 1,000 crore business. So the tagline which was there in 1989, we also make steel, could be relevant 5 years down the line also. I would end with a, since Kiran is asking me to move on, I'll end with a campaign that we did last year, and which actually gave wings to our thoughts, to our aspirations.
पलकों पे सपने कुछ गहरे हल्के सात रंगों में लिपटे लिपटे इन आँखों में सारा जहाँ है थामो इन बाहों को रेशमी
बना रही है कल्पनाएं और स्टील टाटा स्टील वी आल्सो मेक टुमारो
थैंक यू
वंडरफुल सर्विस फ्रॉम बीइंग अ प्रोडक्ट ब्रांड ट्रांजिशनिंग टू अ सर्विस ब्रांड